Hello, my name is Jones Muna. Today, we discuss leadership and management functions. To begin this, let us first define the following terms. Leadership. Leadership is a process whereby an individual influences a group of individuals to achieve a common goal. Management. Management is the process of planning, organizing, leading and controlling the work of organizational members and of using all available resources to reach stated organizational goals. Three ways through which people become leaders. Bayes's theory of leadership. Bayes's theory of leadership states that there are three basic ways to explain how people become leaders. These theories are trait theory. This theory postulates that people are either born or not born with the qualities that predispose them to success in leadership roles. That is, that certain inherited qualities, such as personality and cognitive ability, are what underlie effective leadership. Some personality traits may lead people naturally into leadership roles. The great events theory. A crisis or an important event may cause a person to rise to the occasion, which brings out extraordinary leadership qualities in an ordinary person. Transformational or process leadership theory. This theory states that people can choose to become leaders and can learn leadership skills. This is the most widely accepted theory today and the premise on which this guide is based. Styles of leadership. A leadership style is how a leader uses interpersonal influence to accomplish goals of an organization. Leadership style refers to a leader's behavior. It is the result of the philosophy, personality, and experience of the leader. 1. Democratic leadership style. Democratic leadership style encourages team members to participate in the decisions which need to be made. It creates a form of shared leadership where each team member is invited to share their knowledge, experience, or opinion about a project or situation. Democratic leadership in an organization involves the redistribution of power and authority between employees and managers to provide employee involvement in decision-making. It encourages employees to be a part of the decision-making. I will use this leadership style most of the times to encourage everyone's participation and improve staff morale. 2. Dictatorship leadership style. It is a style of leadership where there is always personal control by the leader-manager over the decision-making process for the team. It is one in which the manager-leader retains power, decision-making, authority, goal-setting, and control and assume full responsibility for all actions. A leader using this style may choose to receive feedback from their team, but any decision is his to make alone. I will use this leadership style when decisions have to be made quickly as there will be no enough time to consult my subordinates. 3. Bureaucratic leadership style. Bureaucratic leadership style is where the manager manages by the book diaresis. Everything is done according to procedure or policy. If it isn't covered by the book, the manager refers to the next level above him or her. This manager is really more of a police officer than a leader. He or she enforces the rules. Bureaucratic leaders also tend to prefer rules, laws, or regulations that are rigid. I will use this leadership style. My subordinates need to understand certain standards or procedures or performing routine tasks over and over. 4. Laissez-faire free-rein delegative leadership style. Laissez-faire leadership, also known as delegative leadership, is a type of leadership style in which leaders are hands-off and allow group members to make the decisions. The leader is only a figurehead. He does not give any directive. A free-rein leader does not lead, but leaves the group entirely to itself. The leader leaves workers without direction, supervision, or coordination. Such a leader allows maximum freedom to subordinates. I will use this leadership style when dealing with non-critical issues, where my subordinates will have freedom to make their own decisions. 5 functions of management that you are going to perform as a ward manager. R. Management functions includes planning. Planning is deciding in advance what to do, when to do it, how to do it, and who to do it. It can also be defined as the process of setting goals, developing strategies, and outlining tasks and schedules to accomplish the goal. Though planning, I will be able to determine what needs to be done, who to do it, and when to be done, e.g. making a timetable for the ward and a duty allocation each day. Organizing. Organizing is the process of identifying and grouping of the works to be performed, defining and delegating responsibility and authority, and establishing relationships for the purpose of enabling people to work most efficiently. It is simply getting prepared for action by arranging for required resources. The function of organizing involves the determination of activities that need to be done and arranging for all required logistics resources in order to reach the organization goals. Through the function of organizing, I will be able to arrange for what to use in the ward, e.g. drugs and medical supplies. Directing. Directing means giving instructions, guiding and counseling, motivating and leading the staff in an organization in doing work to achieve organizational goals. This is making other people work by giving them the plan and leaving them to do the work on their own. Directing involves delegation, supervision, coordination, motivation, and evaluation. Through directing, I will be able to influence and oversee the behavior of the staff in achieving the organization's goals, as well as assisting them in accomplishing their own personal or career goals. Controlling. Controlling is determining what is being accomplished, that is, evaluating performance and, if necessary, applying corrective measures so that performance takes place according to plans. It is ongoing. It involves establishing performance standards based on the organization's objectives and evaluating and reporting actual job performance. Once management has done both of these things, it should compare the two to determine any necessary corrective or preventive action. Through controlling, I will be able to identify any potential problems and take the necessary preventative measures. I will also be able to identify any developing problems that need to be addressed through corrective action. Coordinating. This is bringing people and activities of different group members into harmony to ensure everything that needs to be done is done. Coordination is enhanced by good communication system. I will perform this function to harmonize all activities in the ward so that there will be order. Staffing. Staffing is the function by which managers build an organization through the recruitment, selection, and development of individuals as capable employees. Staffing is that part of the process of management which is concerned with acquiring, developing, employing, appraising, remunerating, and retaining people so that the right type of people are available in right positions and at the right time in the organization. At ward level, I will lobby for more nurses through the Office of Nursing Officer so that my ward is adequately staffed. I will also lobby for staff development through short and long-term trainings to improve knowledge and skills in my staff. Henry Fayol's Principles of Management. Henry Fayol laid down the 14 principles of management. The following are some of the principles of management which most of the managers apply in different organizations. 1. Unity of command. This principle states that every subordinate should receive orders and be accountable to one superior. If an employee receives orders from more than one superior, it is likely to create confusion and conflict. 2. Unity of direction. All those working in the same line of activity must understand and pursue the same objectives. It seeks to ensure unity of action, e.g. those working in medical wards. They should be under the control of one manager. The entire organization should be moving towards a common objective in a common direction. 3. Scalar chain. Scalar chain refers to the chain of superiors ranging from top management to the lowest rank. The principle suggests that there should be a clear line of authority from top to bottom linking all managers at all levels. It is considered a chain of command. 4. Division of work. This is the specialization of the workforce according to the skills of a person, creating specific personal and professional development within the labor force and therefore increasing productivity. 5. Authority and responsibility. Authority means the right of a superior to give orders to his subordinates. Responsibility means obligation for performance. When authority is exercised, responsibility arises. 6. Esprit de corps. This is maintaining teamwork spirit. Team spirit helps develop an atmosphere of mutual trust and understanding. Team increased productivity and effectiveness. 7. Equity. Employees must be treated kindly and alike, provide equal opportunities, and justice must be enacted to ensure a just workplace. Managers should be fair and impartial when dealing with employees. 8. Discipline. Discipline refers to obedience to rules, proper conduct in relation to others, respect of authority. Discipline is essential for the smooth functioning of all organizations. 9. Subordination of individual interest. The management must put aside personal considerations and put company objectives first. Therefore, the interests of goals of the organization must prevail over the personal interests of individuals. 10. Remuneration. Workers must be paid sufficiently, as this is a chief motivation of employees and therefore greatly influences productivity. This means and methods of remuneration should be fair, reasonable, and rewarding of effort. 11. The degree of centralization. Centralization implies the concentration of decision-making authority at the top management. Sharing of authority with lower levels is called decentralization. The organization should strive to achieve a proper balance. 12. Order. The principle states that the material and people should be in the right place all the time. 13. Stability of tenure of personnel. The period of service should not be too short, and employees should not be moved from positions frequently. An employee cannot render useful service if he is removed before he becomes accustomed to the work assigned to him. 14. Initiative. Using the initiative of employees can add strength and new ideas to an organization, and employees are likely to take greater interest in the functioning of the organization. This concludes our discussion for today. Remember to subscribe to my channel, and thanks for listening.